Nanotechnology is the science and engineering of structures, devices, and systems made of atoms arranged on the 1 to 100 nanometer length scale. Operating at the nanoscale allows researchers to achieve novel properties and functions that they couldn't achieve at normal bulk length scales. But the nanoscale is incredibly small, and working at this length scale is a challenge. A nanometer is 10 to the negative 9 meters, which is 1/1 billionth of a meter. That's about 100,000 times smaller than the width of a human hair. Have you ever wondered how scientists and engineers create things so small? Stay tuned to find out. Greetings, Earthlings. Welcome to Science Fictionally True. On this channel, we talk about the real science, technology, and history behind science fiction topics. In this video, we'll do a deep dive into how researchers manufacture nanomaterials and nanostructures. Then, we'll go over the tools that researchers use to study their creations. If you're unfamiliar with nanotechnology, then I recommend you checking out a previous video I made going over the basics before watching this one. Nanoscale manufacturing can be broadly categorized into two approaches, the top-down approach and the bottom-up approach. The top-down approach is by far the more common and more mature of the two approaches. In the top-down approach, you start with a bulk material, then carve away material to create nanoscale features. This is similar to how a sculptor carves away material to create her artwork. The best example of the top-down approach to manufacturing nanotechnology products is from the semiconductor industry. The transistor is a fundamental building block of computer chips. Currently, chip-making giants such as Intel Corporation can make transistors with feature lengths in the single-digit nanometer scale. They start with a large piece of silicon, then use process steps like ion implantation, material deposition and removal, and photolithography to create a functional silicon chip that can compute. Ion implantation is a process that is used to change the material properties of the silicon in select areas. Material deposition is used to lay down materials like dielectrics and metals where you need them. And material removal is used to remove them where they're unwanted. Photolithography is used to create geometric patterns on the piece of silicon and is arguably the most important step that enables nanoscale features. We'll go into greater detail on the role nanotechnology plays in electronics in a future video, so please check it out when it's available. The other approach to manufacturing nanotechnology products is called the bottom-up approach. It's also known as self-assembly. The bottom-up approach is the less mature of the two approaches because bottom-up processes are more difficult to control. Researchers need to come up with clever ways to work with nature to get their components to congregate precisely the way we want them to. Each process is ultimately determined by thermodynamics and will vary depending on the system of materials you're using. You first start with the atoms and or molecules you want to create nanostructures from, then get them together in an environment where they can interact. Some processes involve changing the parameters of the system, usually the temperature, pressure, and constituent material concentrations. By doing so, you've put your system into a higher energy state. The atoms and molecules will naturally rearrange themselves to get into a lower energy state and stop at the equilibrium state, which would be your desired end state. Now, some of the audience might not believe you can create nanoscale structures simply by bringing the right ingredients together and letting them self-assemble. Well, we know it is possible because this process has already been perfected by nature and evolution, not human ingenuity. Biology works because we have nanoscale objects coming together to form complicated, intricate structures like you and I through self-assembly. Researchers are also working on a more nascent and complex bottom-up approach called molecular assembly. This approach was first outlined in nanotechnology pioneer Eric Drexler's book, Engines of Creation. The idea here is to use molecular assemblers with tiny manipulators to precisely position atoms and molecules to build something from the atom up. The idea has been popular in science fiction. Think the replicator from Star Trek. Imagine an army of tiny molecular assemblers working in parallel to build anything you want as long as you have the constituent atoms available. Again, some viewers may not believe something like this is possible. And again, I'll have to say we know it's possible because nature has already done this as well. The ribosome is a macromolecular machine found inside all our cells that perform protein synthesis. By reading instructions of our DNA, it knows how to link constituent amino acids together in just the right ways to make proteins. Ribosomes help create all the living things in our world. Although nature has proven this concept is possible, most scientists and engineers working in nanotechnology believe we are still far away from building a working molecular assembler. However, that's not to say progress hasn't been made on this front. In 2016, the Nobel Prize in Chemistry was awarded to Jean-Pierre Sauvage, Sir Fraser Stoddard, and Bernard Feringa. These chemists were awarded for their work on molecular machines, which date back to 1983. Generally speaking, molecules move in random directions using thermal energy acquired from their environment. However, these three chemists demonstrated that the movement of molecules can actually be choreographed. In 1983, Sauvage succeeded in linking two ring-shaped molecules together to form a chain, called a catenane. The chain was linked by a mechanical bond, unlike traditional chemical bonds, such as ionic or covalent bonds that were used to bonding atoms and molecules together. This was a big deal, because for a machine to perform any task, its parts must be free to move relative to each other. Catenane fulfilled this requirement, marking the advent of molecular machining. In 1991, Stoddard developed rotaxane, which is essentially a threaded molecular ring on a thin molecular axle, and demonstrated the ring was able to move along the axle. And in 1999, Feringa was the first to develop a molecular motor and even got a molecular rotor blade to spin continuously in the same direction. Since then, we've developed a variety of different molecular machines, such as ratchets, elevators, and even nanocars. To date, there hasn't been any commercialized product using any of these molecular machine parts. However, we've proven that there's a lot of ways we can force a molecule to move, and we may find real-world applications for them in the future. As in nanomanufacturing, researchers must also devise clever ways to study their nano creations. If you've ever taken a biology class, you've probably used an optical microscope. By using light to magnify your sample, you can get a close-up look at microscopic organisms. However, to probe nanoscale features, we'll need things with a better resolution and more magnifying power, which means different and more complex tools. Electron microscopy is commonly employed to image samples in nanotechnology labs. There are two major categories of electron microscopy: scanning electron microscopy, or SEM, and transmission electron microscopy, or TEM. In SEM, an electron gun accelerates a beam of electrons onto your sample, and the beam scans the sample surface. All this happens in vacuum because the electrons are easily scattered by air. The incident electrons get scattered elastically and inelastically by the sample, and the scattered electrons gets picked up by a detector. That interaction results in a signal to your detector, and a computer turns that signal into a picture on a computer monitor. By looking at different ways your incident electron beam is scattered by your sample, you can image the sample's topography and distinguish the different materials your sample contains. The best SEMs today can achieve about 1 million times magnification. Preparing a sample for SEM is quick and easy, which means you can get an image easily. All that's needed is a conductive surface. Ideally, your sample would be metallic. If not, no big deal, because you can easily sputter a thin conductive film onto the surface. For these reasons, out of the two electron microscopy methods, SEM is far more commonly employed in labs. If you need even better resolution, like to resolve individual atoms, then you need to use transmission electron microscopy, or TEM. The best TEMs today can achieve magnifications beyond 50 million times. To give you a sense of how powerful TEM is, the image shown is a TEM image of Intel's super thin transistor. At the time this video was created, this was their latest transistor technology, with their smallest achievable 10 nanometer feature length. In TEM, electrons must pass through the sample to generate the image, hence transmission in the name. In order to get electrons to pass through the sample, the sample must be very thin, on the order of a few tens of micrometers. This means lots of time spent precisely slicing and polishing the sample for preparation. Also, in order to generate a beam of electrons with enough energy to pass through the sample, you need much higher voltages, which translate into higher equipment costs. Furthermore, the TEM is a much more complicated beast than the SEM, so it requires extensive training. Because TEMs are so complex and expensive, it is not as commonly used in labs. It's only employed if SEM cannot give you the resolution you want. Some refer to SEMs as the workhorses and TEMs as the thoroughbreds of electron microscopy. If you need an image of a sample surface at atomic scale resolution, but don't need to view the sample's internal structure, researchers will turn to atomic force microscopy. This is how it works. A tip with a width that can be smaller than a nanometer is attached to a cantilever, similar to needles used on record players back in the day. A laser beam is aimed at and reflected off the cantilever, and the reflected laser beam is picked up by a detector. The AFM tip scans the surface, moving up and down as it scans because of the surface topography. The up and down movements cause laser beam shifts to be picked up by the detector. Finally, by tracking the laser beam shifts, a computer can extract a topographical image of the sample surface with resolution good enough to resolve the positions of individual atoms. The image presented shows individual COVID-19 virions, or virus particles, imaged using an AFM. AFM imaging revealed the 3D morphology of the structurally intact virions. The last imaging tool we'll cover today is the scanning tunneling microscope, or STM. Like AFMs, STMs can achieve atomic scale resolution, but also has the power to move individual atoms around. This is how it works. An STM tip is made to be about one atom wide and brought very close to the sample surface, about 1 nanometer. At this close, electrons from the sample can actually quantum tunnel to the tip. We discussed quantum tunneling in detail in a previous episode, so please check it out if you need a refresher. For our intents and purposes, you can consider that the gap between the surface and the tip to be an energy barrier the electron sees. The probability of quantum tunneling depends sensitively on the barrier width. If the tip gets close enough, then the barrier width becomes small enough to induce quantum tunneling of electrons from the surface to the tip, generating a measurable current. Then, we have the tip scan throughout the surface. A closer tip would generate more current, and a further tip would generate less current. Finally, after the tip has finished scanning the region of interest, a computer maps out the changes in current to produce a topographical image of the sample. But I said earlier, STMs can also move individual atoms around. So how does it do that? First, you would position the STM tip above an atom. If you lower the tip to just the right distance, van der Waals forces between the tip and the atom become strong enough to make the atoms stick to the tip. This allows you to move the atom laterally. After you moved the atom to the desired spot, you can raise the tip, thereby releasing the van der Waals forces to set the atom in place. The National Institutes of Standards and Technology, or NIST, and the company IBM have actually spelled out their names using individual atoms with an STM to demonstrate this ability. If you could move individual atoms around, what would you design? Please let us know in the comments below. In 1959, American theoretical physicist Richard Feynman gave a seminal talk at Caltech titled, "There's Plenty of Room at the Bottom." Feynman speculated on all the things that would be possible if we could arrange the atoms in matter one by one, precisely the way we wanted. Well, the tools to make and study matter on the nanoscale are getting better and better. Feynman said that the technological applications of this power were endless. So, what technologies will we make with the power we wield? Thanks for watching, Earthlings. In my next video, we'll discuss how nanotechnology is revolutionizing our electronics industry. Thanks, and see y'all next time.